Of the last topic that we have discussed. So we are discussing about storage management. We are discussing this under four headings: file system management, mass storage management, cache memory, and I/O system. So we have discussed about file system management and mass storage management in the previous lecture. So in this lecture, we will be discussing about cache memory and I/O system. As already discussed, the general definition of cache memory is: a cache memory is a high-speed memory which is placed in between the processor and the main memory. So the more frequently accessed contents from the main memory will be copied into cache memory, and whenever processor needs any data, first it will check the cache memory. If the data is in the cache memory, then it will access it quickly. If it is not available in the cache memory, then it will go back and refer to the main memory. So this is how cache memory works. Okay. So generally, cache memory is placed between processor and main memory. Okay. But considering the memory hierarchy or storage hierarchy, there are different levels of storage. Okay. First, we have registers. So registers are placed inside the CPU. Okay. Then we have cache memory. There are two types of cache memory: internal cache and external cache. The cache that is inside the processor is called as internal cache, and the cache that is outside the processor is called as external cache. And then we have main memory, and then we have solid state disks, and then we have magnetic disks, and then we have tapes. Okay, so these are the memory hierarchy. Okay, so even though the generic definition of cache memory says that the cache memory is a high speed memory placed in between processor and the main memory, considering the different level of storage hierarchy we are having, so what we can say in the sense, magnetic disk acts as a cache memory for tapes, because whatever available in the tapes will also be copied into disk. Okay, and solid state disk, if you have a solid state disk in your computer, this will act as a cache memory for magnetic disk, because whatever in magnetic disk will also be the important part. I mean, not everything, whatever the most frequently used part of magnetic disk will be in solid state disk. Similarly here also, the most frequently used content of tapes will be copied to magnetic disk, and the most frequently copied content of disk will be copied to solid state disk. Okay, and the most frequently used content from solid state disk will be copied to main memory. Okay, all these are permanent storage devices. Okay, whereas starting from main memory, these are volatile. And the more frequently used content from main memory will be copied to cache memory. And from cache memory, the data which is most frequently used will be copied to registers. So in this context, we can say that magnetic disks acts as a cache memory for tapes, and solid state disk act as a cache memory for magnetic disk, and main memory acts as a cache memory for solid state disk, and cache memory, so this is a cache memory for main memory, and register acts as a cache memory for the cache memory. Okay, so in this context, we can say that there are several levels of cache available. Okay, so this is one view of cache memory. Okay, fine. Now we will try to understand the various features of these different storage devices. Okay, so this diagram helps us to understand in a better way as of the current scenario. So if you take the typical size of the registers, it will be less than 1 kilobyte. Cache memory, it will be less than 16 MB. Main memory, it will be less than 64 GB. 64 GB itself is a very huge capacity. Solid state disk, it will be less than 1 terabytes. Magnetic disks, it will be less than 10 terabytes. Okay. And implementation technologies. So registers are implemented using CMOS technology. Okay. And cache memory is also implemented using CMOS technology. Okay. And main memory is also implemented using CMOS SRAM technology. Okay. And solid state disks are implemented. Solid state disks are one form of flash memory. Flash memory is something which is similar to the pen drive. Whatever the content you have in pen drive, you know. So the pen drive is made up. The pen drive is also made up of flash memory. Okay. And magnetic disks are coated with magnetic oxide. Okay. CMOS stands for complementary metal oxide semiconductor. Okay. So basically, register, main memory, cache memory, all these are one or other form of CMOS technology. And access time, if you see, so these devices can be accessed at a very faster rate when compared to these devices. Okay. As you move towards here, as you move towards, the access time increases. Okay. It means they are slower to access. So registers can be accessed within a very less time, from 0.25 nanoseconds to 0.5 nanosecond. And content in cache memory can be accessed from 0.5 nanoseconds to 25 nanoseconds. And main memory contents can be accessed between 80 nanoseconds to 250 nanoseconds. Okay, whereas if you see solid state disk, it takes this much time for the processor to access, 25,000 to 50,000 nanoseconds. Magnetic disks, even more. Okay. Bandwidth. Bandwidth represents amount of data transfer, at what rate they can transfer data. Again, if you see, so these devices can transfer data at a very faster rate. So it means the how much data can be transferred per second, how much megabytes of data can be transferred per second. This can, registers can transfer this much megabytes of data per second, 20,000 megabytes, that is 20 GB to 1 terabytes. But register will not have that much content. It will have hardly 1 kilobyte, but that is the transfer rate. And cache memory can transfer at this rate. Main memory can transfer at this rate, 1000 to 5000 megabytes. That is 1 GB to 5 GB per second. Okay. Whereas if you come to solid state disk, the transfer rate is reducing. It is 500 megabytes. That is 0.5 GB per second. Okay. Magnetic disk, the data transfer rate is still reducing. Okay. And registers are controlled by the compiler. And cache memory is controlled by the hardware. Okay. Main memory is controlled by the operating system. Solid state disks and magnetic disks are also controlled or managed by the operating system. Okay. So the contents of register will be backed up in the cache memory. Okay. So that is, whatever in register will also be available in the cache memory. So cache memory, this is cache memory, right? So contents of register will be backed in the cache memory. And the content of cache memory will be backed in main memory. Content of main memory will be cached in the disk. Okay. And that is any disk. If you have solid state disk, it will be backed in the solid state disk. And the content of solid state disk will also be backed in the magnetic disk or any other disk. And the content of magnetic disk will be backed up in the tape, or if you have any other magnetic disk for that purpose. Okay. So this actually gives a brief overview of the memory hierarchy with various features, and also it discusses that the The generic definition of cache is a high speed memory placed in between processor and main memory, but still you can consider there are different levels of cache. That you can say that magnetic disk is a cache for tapes, and solid state disk is a cache for magnetic disk, and main memory is a cache for solid state disk, and so on and so forth. Okay, here is an example for cache memory. It is a very interesting example. Let us assume there is a variable A. There is a variable A, and that is stored in hot disk. Okay. Now let us see how it will be cached. How it will be cached. Now what happens if processor wants this A content? Okay, say A has some value. Say it has 25. Now if processor wants this, then what will happen? A copy of this will be moved to main memory. A copy of this will be moved to main memory. So A also comes here. Again the copy of that will be moved to cache memory. So A also comes here. Okay. Now again the copy of that will be moved to registers. Okay. So registers are very close to the processor. So processor can now access A at a very faster rate, and it performs some computation. After performing some computation, say processor has made some change to A. So previously A is 25, say now A becomes 60. Okay, now what happens is once that job is completed, the content should be updated. So what the processor will do, or what the operating system will do, first that content whatever in register will be updated in the cache memory. So this will become 60. Now from cache, now the cache memory content will be updated to main memory. So this will also become 60. Now the main memory content will be updated in the hard disk. So this will also become 60. Okay. So this is how the cache memory works. Okay. So if there is only one process, then this content updation becomes easier. But assume a multi-processing environment. Assume there are more than one process running simultaneously, and this value A is shared among multiple process. Okay, say for example you have two process, I have two process, say P1 and P2. P1 is also accessing A, and P2 is also accessing A. Okay, P1 is also accessing A. And P2 is also accessing A. Okay. Now, when A is updated to 60, that information should be known both to P1 and also to P2. Okay. If it is not known, then it will create issue. Okay. So this is the case with multi-programming environment. But assume a multi-processor environment. That is, your system has two processor. Your computer is having two processor, CPU1 and CPU2. Say let us assume this is CPU1, I am calling it as C1. Similarly, let us assume this is CPU2. So this is CPU2, okay? This CPU2. Now this A should be available in the registers of both the CPU. A should be available here, okay? And also A should be available here, okay? If any one of the processor changes the content of the A, then it should be reflected in the other processor also. Okay, this is A. Okay, so if the CPU1 changes the content of A, then it should reflect in CPU2 also. So whenever CPU1 is changing A, it should tell CPU2 also that I have made A's content to something, so that it will reflect in the other process. Okay, so multiprocessor environment should ensure that whenever there is some changes happen in one register, it should reflect in others also. So this concept is called as cache coherence. This concept is called as cache coherence. That is, the multiprocessor environment must provide cache coherency in hardware such that all CPUs have the most recent value in their cache memory. Okay. So in a distributed environment like a clustering system, dealing with this cache becomes even a difficult problem. it increases, it adds more complexity. So what is a clustering system? Clustering system in the sense you have different physical systems. So different physical systems are clustered together, and in that case, if there is a shared variable like A or something, then if one of the system is modifying A, then it should reflect in all the other systems also. Okay, so this is about cache memory, right? So we have discussed the general definition of cache, and also we have discussed the memory hierarchy, and we discussed that considering the memory hierarchy, you can say that a magnetic disk acts as a cache memory for tapes, and solid state disk acts as a cache memory for magnetic disk, and main memory acts as a cache memory for solid state disk, and so on and so forth. And here we have discussed how the content is copied from one memory to another memory, and how it is cached, and how when it is modified by the processor, how it should reflect in the other areas. Okay, so in a multiprocessor environment, we should ensure that the cache is coherent. So that concept is called as cache coherence. Okay, that is, when there is any update in the cache memory, it should reflect in all other related processor also. Okay, so that's it about cache memory. So the next concept we'll be discussing is I/O system, I/O subsystem. Okay. See, one of the core purpose of the operating system is to hide the complexity of different hardware devices, complexity or what you can say in the sense unique nature of different hardware system. Okay, see, different hardware devices may work in different style. It is not that all hardware system will work in the same principle. Okay, but user need not know these details. This should be hidden from the user. So operating system will ensure that is hidden from the user. With respect to user feels as if all hardware devices are working in the same way. So operating system should ensure that. So that is the role of operating system with respect to managing I/O devices. Okay. So the typical I/O device will perform these tasks. It may perform buffering, caching, and spooling. Buffering in the sense, when a buffer is basically a temporary storage in the I/O device. Normally, every I/O device will have a buffer. For example, keyboard will have a buffer. Whatever we type something, it directly don't go to the processor or the main memory. First, it will be stored in the keyboard buffer. A small storage will be available in the keyboard. That is called as buffer. From there, it will be moved to the main memory. Similarly, printer will have a buffer. So when any job comes to the printer, it will be stored in the print buffer. From there, it will get printed. Okay. So this buffer mechanism may vary from one hardware device to another hardware device. So it is the operating system is the one which manages these buffer. Similarly, these devices may also have some cache memory for temporary storage. For example, printer cannot go back to main memory to access any content. So it will also maintain some cache memory. Okay. Similarly, there is something called as spooling. The output of one process may be, or one job may be an input for another job. Okay. So in an I/O operation, for example, there are two jobs. Okay. And the output of the first job may be the input for the second job. So that is called as spooling. Okay. So how this is implemented in different hardware, that will be hidden to the user by the operating system, and operating system ensures that it is properly hidden, and it provides a uniform or a similar interface to the user irrespective of the type of the devices. Okay, so this is how the operating system manages the I/O devices. Okay, so with this this topic will stop. So what we have discussed here in the sense about storage management. So we have discussed storage management under four headings: file system management, mass storage management, cache memory, and IO subsystem. Okay, so in today's class we have discussed about cache memory and IO subsystem. Fine, we'll stop here. Thank you.